Hello, I'd like to welcome everyone out to the Northeastern Utah Regional Advisory Council meeting for April 14th, 2022. I'm Brett Previdel. I'm the current chair of this group. And I'll take a moment to let them introduce themselves. We'll start down on the end with Dusty.
I'm Dusty Carpenter. I'm with the BLM.
I'm Daniel Davis, sportsman's rep.
Natasha Haddon, U.S. Fish Forest Service.
I almost said fish wildlife.
I'm Miles Hamburg. I'm the regional supervisor for the Division of Wildlife Resources.
Commissioner Brad Horrocks, elected officials.
Mike Smith, I represent the non-consumptive wildlife users.
Richie Anderson.
And I believe Joe Arnold is joining us remotely. He's representative of the public at large. I'd like to welcome the division wildlife personnel here. And Miles already introduced himself. So with that, I believe we can go into the agenda. Have you had an opportunity to look at the agenda? I need a motion to approve tonight's agenda, if so.
I'll make a motion to approve the agenda.
I'll second it.
Motion's made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Tonight, we'll be able to go with just regular roll call. We won't check through the names like we have been. If Joe wants to vote, we'll ask him for the one vote, but we'll just do it with raise of hands tonight. I now would entertain a motion to approve the minutes from our last meeting.
Mr. Chairman, I'd make the motion that we approve the minutes from our, what was the date on that meeting? Do I need to have that in there? But our last meeting, I guess.
It was in January, and I'm not sure the exact date.
It was December.
It was late December.
I'll second that motion.
We'll put that in the minutes. We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, thank you. I'll take a moment, and it's been a while since we met, but I will take a moment and go over the motions and the decisions that were made at the last Wildlife Board meeting. The big issue on the Wildlife Board agenda was the trail cam and technology issue. The night vision devices were part of that. The marketing of media was part of it. And then there was a discussion about the fixed data cameras and the transmitting cameras. And so there was a lot of discussion on it. The other racks had varying opinions. If you remember, this rack recommended that the fixed storage cameras be allowed and the transmitting ones be made illegal during the hunting season. And then I think it was consistent around the state with the night vision devices and the sale and purchase of media that all the racks had recommended that they be made against the rules. So there was a lot of debate, and the ultimate decision of the Wildlife Board was to make it illegal to use night vision devices from 48 hours before any big game hunt in the area through 48 hours after the big game hunt in that area. It was illegal to engage in the sale or purchase of media, trail cam media, including images, video location, time, and date data. And that was identified to aid in the take of big game. And then the Wildlife Board, after much deliberation, made a motion to make it illegal for all trail cams from August 1st to January 31st to aid in the take of big game. And that was a split vote, 3-3. And the chairman voted in favor of that ban. So it was passed. And then I'll deviate a little bit from these minutes. Then because of the amount of letters that came in and opposition to that motion, I'm not the correct one to explain exactly why, but it met a threshold that said there had to be another hearing, a public hearing. And the Wildlife Board had that public hearing, and the vote was upheld. And actually, one of the Wildlife Board members actually changed the vote in favor of the ban, so it was not a tie vote. So instead of 3-3 with the chairman breaking the vote or breaking the tie, it was 4-2 to uphold the original motion. So where we're at right now is it's illegal for trail cams from August 1st to January 31st for the aid intake of big game. And then all the other technology issues. There was some discussion about Hunter Orange and the recommended change in the rules. And I'm not sure we didn't have that locally. That was a Wildlife Board issue. And so I'm not really sure I understand exactly what the changes were. Does anyone, law enforcement or anyone, have that, what they approved there on the Hunter Orange? Do you know?
I'm trying to remember.
Allow the first 5 days in the youth hunt, those archery hunters that were still hunting, not have to wear Hunter Orange during the first 5 days.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's correct. It took me a minute to think about that.
So, because the current rule said that if there's a hunt going on in the area.
Correct. If there's a center fire charge hunt going on in the area, typically supposed to have 400 square inches, but this was to make an allowance for those first five.
For that overlap with the youth hunt. Okay. Thank you for clarifying that. The fur bearer and bobcat recommendations were approved as presented. There was a Northern Region Advisory Council proposal to allow the take of collared lions in areas where the study has ended. And that passed. There was some motions about aligning season dates for the harvest objective and the spot and stock on cougars, and that passed. There was some a motion regarding the way that damages are calculated for landowners getting damage from big game. And I know there was a follow-up on that with some state statute that said it can only be the current loss that's compensated. There was some discussion. There was some application for losses from orchards for future years because of the damage that had been done to the trees by the big game. And so that is shaken out through the rules that it's just the damage that was done at the time, not perceived future damage. And I believe that was the bulk of it. Most of the time was spent talking about the technology issue. There was a follow-up item where there was a, on the action log, they're gonna work with the DWR to establish a technology effectiveness committee to try to stay ahead of the technology, which is moving faster than we can address annually in these meetings. And so they're gonna try to have a committee that gets a little ahead of the game on that. That's a fair way to say it. And I believe that's what happened at the last Wildlife Board meeting and their follow-up public meeting. Miles, if you'd take a moment and talk about regional update.
Sure. So first of all, just Natasha Haddon is now, she's formerly with BLM and on the RAC, but now she is a Forest Service rep. Dana Beta had served just over 8 years as the Forest Service rep. So he's passed that torch over to Natasha now, so she gets to be back with us again. Tim Ignacio, he's here with us tonight. He's with the Ute Tribe. And Tim, you're welcome to sit up here in the front with the other RAC members, but Tim's the representative for the Ute Tribe.
Thank you.
Yep. So with that, I'll talk about a few things. I won't spend a ton of time because I know we're going to have a lot of discussion tonight. But, you know, right now it's a busy time of year as everyone's ramping up to do field work. We're also scrambling to budget and get work planning efforts planned for this next year. And so it's really a busy time of year for the Division of Wildlife. And for many of us, it's a busier time of year now than even during the hunting season. So, but I'll just highlight a few things that's going on around the region. And I apologize. I had a PowerPoint ready for this and I left my flash drive. I didn't quite have time enough to go retrieve it. So you just get to hear me talk tonight and not any auto visuals. So I had some cool pictures to show you, but we'll try to do better next time. Our aquatics folks are busy right now. It's a time of year when they're really starting to ramp up a lot of sampling. One of the big efforts going on this spring is down at Pelican Lake. They're doing some carp removal efforts as those carp come in to spawn right now. That's a good time to be able to target them in shallow water and do some removals on those. Saw a picture I was going to show you of a carp that was removed out of there last week. It was approaching eight or so pounds, so it's a big fish. One of the cool things with this carp problem, if we can have a problem, just we'll make some lemonade out of the with the lemons that presents. But we're going to be looking at doing some tag incentivized programs to where if you catch or remove one of those carp, it would be a cash reward. So it's kind of bittersweet to catch it. One of these types of fish and then tag it and turn it loose when we're trying to get rid of them. But in the end, it actually ends up resulting in increased removals by doing those kinds of programs. And we've done that with Burbot Flame Gorge for a number of years with the Burbot Bash and other programs. So I guess we're just encouraging anglers. Carp are a lot of fun to catch. They fight hard. Bow fishermen, anybody to go down to Pelican Lake and do removals for us. Pelican Lake, it's a place where we still are trying to work on water quality. It's full right now, but with these wind events, some of those exposed shorelines, especially on the south, we're getting a lot of turbidity into that lake from the wave action. We've implemented a few programs with reef ball structures. I think I might have shown a picture at the last RAC meeting. We're just going to have to do a lot more of those kinds of things to try to keep that turbidity down. And it's really interesting aerial photos from this spring that just showed some of that after some strong wind events and different things of how the turbidity spread across the lake. For a sight feeder like a bluegill, they need to be able to see and have good clean water. So it really impacts those species. We've also been doing gill netting on tiger muskie at some of our tiger muskie waters. We do have some tiger muskie in Pelican Lake to help control carp right now, but we had good success and caught a number of large tiger muskie out of places like Cottonwood Reservoir. I think some of those were 34, 35 inches, so they're big trophy fish. It's a good opportunity for folks in the basin to be able to go target those. I think it's somewhat of an underutilized resource around here, considering the size of some of those fish. It's also the time when our natives aquatics folks are ramping up efforts. They're doing a lot of pike minnow sampling on the Green River right now, and they'll be busy doing that for the next few weeks. Our wildlife folks, it's a time of year when sage grouse are strutting. So they're out doing sage-grouse surveys. Unfortunately, we can't make it to all of our leks due to snow drifts and snow right now. But so far, the good news is leks counts seem to be improving this year. And sage-grouse populations tend to be somewhat cyclic, and it looks like we're on the upswing of those populations right now. So we'll see how that data closes out. But good news is it looks like those populations are on the uptick. We also are spending a lot of time right now dealing with depredation damage with elk, particularly along the south slope with the spring conditions. A lot of those elk try to come into folks' fields. And so our folks are spending a lot of time trying to address those issues right now. We had a mountain goat viewing event, I think 2 weeks ago now, over at Rock Creek. And so we had over 150 people attend that event. And so it was a good success. A lot of people come out from the Wasatch Front to attend that, and people are just itching to get outdoors, especially after a long winter. We're also kind of promoting loon watching here in the region. This is one of the best places in the state to actually see loons as they're moving back north on their migration. So places like Steinecker Reservoir, you can see them, Starvation, just different reservoirs around the region, you'll be able to see loons. And for those of you that may have not been out listening to them, they have a really distinctive call that's really pretty interesting. But it's a good time to see them as they move back north into Montana and Canada, even upwards towards Alaska. Our habitat folks remain busy, really ramping up work as we're able to get in the field now. Just finished some aprons on some guzzlers out in Pleasant Valley area to try to help out pronghorn out there. And also really preparing to do a big project in May where we'll be flying in materials and for a number of guzzlers over on the East Fork Fire and then also on the Dollar Ridge Fire, replacing some guzzlers that were destroyed by those wildfires, but also while they're in the business, to add a couple of guzzlers in those areas too. So the feed's great in those burns, so if we can add a little bit of water, we'll really get some good use out of in those areas. And lastly, with the habitat, it's the time of year where we've been really busy proposing projects and trying to line up funding sources for those. And that's looking really good right now. It looks like we'll have a lot of work to do this next fiscal year. So anyhow, that's, I think, a quick and dirty update of what some of the things are going on in the region. And again, anybody on the racks, welcome to come out with some of our biologists and our staff at any time to see some of these things and participate. So so with that, that's the conclusion of my update, unless somebody has any questions.
Thank you, Miles. I forgot to talk a little bit procedure. The public that's here, if you want to talk, I don't think we got the card set up, but just I'll offer you at each topic, I'll give you opportunity. If you want to come up, please state your name. And you can have 3 minutes. How's that sound? All right. Okay.
Is this on the
clock
there now?
We'll discuss each issue, and then we'll ask for comments during each issue. So with that, we can roll into item number 5 on the agenda, which is the buck deer permit recommendations. I don't see Kobe here. Justin, are you going to be the Dex? Is Dex going to be the presenter on this?
Hello. I'm Dex Mangus from the Regional Wildlife Manager.
Man, those guys are quick to yell at you if you don't turn the mic on. I'm Dax Mangus. I'm the Regional Wildlife Program Manager. I'm filling in for Covey. As you know, the presentations are online. I can hopefully answer especially region-specific questions. If we've got questions from other parts of the state, I can take a stab at those. And we've also got Riley Peck here in person, and I think Kent Hersey may be calling in virtually if we need help as well. So.
So we have the tables that were available online, and you know, in general, or the division is recommending a slight to moderate reduction in buck deer tags, though some places state are doing better than others, and it may not be a reduction across the board. And so I'd open that up to questions for Dax from the RAC.
Mike, I guess I can give just a little overview, kind of big picture.
Please do.
You know, we make our recommendations for the deer permits based on our management plans and the criteria in the management plans. How we hunt buck deer is separate from how we really manage deer populations. There's a lot of room between like the biological side boards for how many bucks you have on the landscape. It's really more of a social measure of quality by having, you know, more bucks left after the hunts tends to create a hunt that, you know, fewer tags, higher quality animals, higher success rate. By quality, I mean antler size, less opportunity, fewer tags on units that are managed for higher buck to doe ratios, on units that are managed for lower buck to doe ratios. It's the opposite of that, you know, more tags, more opportunity, typically younger animals or animals with smaller antlers. And we have a variety of different types of deer units in the state, and the recommendations that the biologists have made are based on, you know, the direction that the plans have directed them to manage those, you know, that opportunity. In our region, you know, just because we're kind of the tail end a drought cycle. We're in a drought cycle, and our deer populations have declined. And so on most of our units, we've made adjustments. On some units, we're continuing to make adjustments just because there are fewer deer available. So we have to reduce permits on some of those units to stay at the objectives, the buck to doe ratio objectives in our plans. A couple of our units are pretty stable, staying about where they are. It's kind of a mixed bag, but generally the trend overall is, you know, populations are down a little bit in the state, probably most likely due to drought, and then permits are, you know, recommended adjustments are based on that.
Thank you. Just a brief on the general buck deer. I'll just briefly go through the ones that are in the region here. 9 miles, not technically in our region, but I'll list that one off also. 9 miles recommendation. Last year was 1650. This year it's 1500, slightly down. North Slope is recommended to stay the same at 2400. South Slope Bonanza Vernal is recommended to stay the same at 1200. South Slope Yellowstone's down 100 from 1400 to 1300. And then Wasatch Mountains East is recommended to stay the same. So in our region, not a lot of changes in the general buck deer. And I think that's fairly consistent with the limited entry buck deer also, with the exception of probably the book lifts, right?
Yes, the recommended reduction.
We do have a, like most of our general season deer units, we're pretty close to where we want to be. Pretty minor adjustments, just a few percent here and there. A little bit more aggressive adjustment in the book cliffs, going from, I have the numbers right here, going from 264 permits last year, limited entry deer permits in the book cliffs, to 200 recommended this year. And again, it's just that book cliffs unit is one where that decline is really, we're seeing it more than about anywhere else in our region. It's just an arid unit, limited summer range, and the drought impacts seem to be, you know, really taking a toll on that unit.
And as you see on the agenda, we're going to do the buck deer first, both limited entry and general as far as motions, and then we'll move into the elk and pronghorn. Is there any questions after hearing that from the RAC? Any comments from the RAC? How about the public? You want to address the buck deer? Please step up, and you can ask a question. If you do have a card, I'll sure take it. Thank you. Ray Thomas.
I'm actually here kind of representing SFW Sports and Fish and Wildlife. So they sent me this to read off here, I guess. So they said SFW supports the division's recommendations with the following exceptions. Fillmore general season buck deer. The division recommended increasing permits by 200 to 1,400 total permits. SFW recommends cutting permits by 200 for a total of 1,000 permits. The three-year average buck-to-doe ratio is still at 17, and the unit objective is 18 to 20. Beaver general season buck deer. The division recommended a cut from 1,400 to 1,200. SFW recommends to cut an additional 400 tags for a total of 800 permits. The three-year average buck-to-doe ratio is very low at 14, and the unit objective is 18 to 20. Panguitch Lake General Deer. The division recommended to increase by 500. SFW recommends an increase of only 250. The three-year average buck-to-doe ratio is low at 16, and the unit objective is 18 to 20. We understand last year's buck-to-doe ratio made a big jump, but we don't want to run with just that number. That is why the deer plans run a three-year average. Fillmore Oak Creek limited entry buck deer, no tag increase. That's it. Thank you.
What was the number recommend on the Panguitch Lake? Was that 1450? Is that what I heard you say?
Panguitch Lake was
your recommendation.
The division recommended an increase by 500. SFW recommends an increase of only 250.
Okay, so that would be 14.
Yeah,
1450. Yeah. Okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. JC, were you wanting to comment on this topic? Okay. So with that, is there any more discussion from the RAC on buck deer, either general or limited entry? You heard the recommendations from Sportsman's for Fish and Wildlife, which deviates. It's consistent that it's recommending less tags than the division on them three units. And if everybody's comfortable, I'd entertain a motion of where we'd like to go with this.
Mr. Chair, I'll make a shot at it. I looking at the numbers there, and I have a tendency to agree with SFW's recommendations. And looking at the three-year average is what they'd presented there, and I'd make the motion that we go with what the permit numbers were from the SFW presenter.
And on the remainder of the packet, are you saying DWR
yes
recommend on the remainder?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, we have a motion on the table to accept the division's recommendation, with the exception of Beaver, Fillmore, and Panguitch Lake, in which case the permits would be reduced accordingly to the recommendation from the Sportsman's and for Fish and Wildlife. Do we have a second on that motion?
I'll second that.
You got this, Miles. You got the motion. Okay. So we have a motion. We have a second. I did not see Joe on there, so we'll just vote here locally. We have a motion, a second. I'll take a vote. All in favor?
Show of hands or?
Show of hands.
Oh,
those opposed? Motion passes 4-3. Okay, thank you. We will now move into the bull elk and buck pronghorn recommendations. Do you want to give a brief summary of that, Dex?
Yep. So for pronghorn, we manage based on an age, average age of harvested bucks. It's 2.5 to 3. Is that right? And so we look at we have the hunter set in teeth cut the teeth and look at the cementum annuli, the growth rings. They put down a ring during periods of nutritional shortage. And so we look at the age of harvested bucks after the hunts, and then make a recommendation. You know, if we're above that age objective, we would recommend an increase. If we're below it, we'd recommend a decrease. And so that's what we've done. In some portions of the state, even though they're a little bit over the age objective, they're documenting really poor fawn production. And so they're not making as high recommendations, as big of increases on some of the units that they're over in some parts of the state. In our region, we've been pretty consistently over that age objective. And we've also had a lot of issues with pronghorn, especially in our ag areas in like Ouray Valley and Pleasant Valley. And so we've pretty consistently recommended fairly substantial increases based on the fact that we've been over the age objective, have really high buck-to-doe ratios, and have a lot of conflicts on private ag lands. So on elk, again, we manage our elk units based on average harvested age of bulls, and we've got, different units with different objectives. And again, we look at, we send those teeth into the lab and get them aged, and then make recommendations to adjust permit numbers, up or down, or keep them the same depending on what those ages are doing on those units. In our region, most of ours are pretty minimal adjustments. The Book Cliffs unit, again, just overall that whole unit seems to be struggling, and we've seen that age on harvested bulls continue to go down for the Bitter Creek South unit. So we're recommending about a 25% decrease there, to go from 100 permits to 75 permits. We made a really substantial cuts in the roadless area of the Book Cliffs as well. It's managed for the highest age objective. And we're recommending adding one permit back into the roadless, just because there was a conservation permit we hadn't accounted for. Last year we had to make an emergency change and add that permit, but it's a fairly low number. We did see the age jump back up in the roadless area this last year, but it was a pretty small sample size. So most of the other units in our region are fairly minimal adjustments. We also do have on the Nine Mile Anthro unit, it's managed in a different way. It's an archery hunt the whole month of September, and then a hams hunt. Ham stands for handgun, archery, muzzleloader, or shotgun, with no optics allowed. And we have a hams hunt that's later, like in October and into November. That last year was the first year we had that hunt. The idea behind that hunt was that by restricting to more primitive weapons, we could issue more permits, provide more opportunity. And on the archery hunt, success rates were about where they normally were. During the hams portion, we actually had pretty high success rate and ended up harvesting about the same number of elk as we had harvested in the past on that unit. So we're recommending an increase on the anthro of 10 additional permits during the archery hunt, 10 additional permits during the hams hunt, to try to continue to give a little more opportunity there. That's about it for elk recommendations, kind of an overview of elk recommendations in our region.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I need to declare a conflict of interest with the South Slope Diamond Mountain unit. I'm a landowner up there. So
okay.
I've been told two different ways, and maybe I don't know how the division's always done it. I've been told that as long as you declare, you can still vote. And then I've been told that you can't. So I don't know how we've handled that. Miles, do you know? I've been given two answers, one by the Uinta County Attorney, and he said, as long as you declare, you can. But then I'd checked with somebody besides a county agent, and they said, no, you can't, as far as something outside of the county. So I'm not quite positive.
I would just probably not vote on this issue, because we have a quorum without you. And that'd be the cleanest. That'd be my recommendation, unless you feel strongly that you want to vote.
No, I'm good.
Okay.
No, I'm good.
Okay.
Yeah, the Attorney General office has said that if there's a conflict or even a perceived conflict, it shouldn't vote. And so that's the direction we've gotten there.
Okay, thank you. Just a brief summary. As Dax mentioned, there's a pretty significant reduction in Book Cliffs from 100 to 75. 100 to 75. The Little Creek Roadless, we had a big reduction last year, and it's fairly stable from 7 to 8. So it's up one tag, but that's down from historic numbers. I'm just browsing through the ones in our region. The North Slope Three Corners is recommended to stay the same at 25 tags. And the South Slope Diamond Mountain that we just discussed is actually recommended that we increase six from 61 to 67. And Wasatch Mountains, what kind of laps over into our area, there's a fairly significant increase there from,
Wasatch should be the same.
I'm just looking at the wrong column. It's recommended to stay the same at 948. And then as Dax mentioned on the hams hunt, the recommendation is to go, it was 20 and 20 last year, 20 archery and 20 hams. This year, the recommendation is 30 and 30. I'd open that up to discussion from the RAC or questions for Dax. Everybody's quiet this evening.
I got a question. Why did we do this a long time ago? Why didn't we start cutting the back when they go to you guys?
We'll get you on the mic for the public.
Yeah, I was just asking Dax why we didn't do this 4 years, 5 years ago.
So, like I mentioned, we managed those age objectives. I was looking at Book Cliff's ages, and we really, if you look at the 3 year average versus year to year, we really didn't drop below the 3 year average in the Book Cliffs until 2-3 years ago, which is when we started cutting permits. And so we've cut them pretty aggressively. You know, we're down to less than half of what we were given 4 or 5 years ago. So, and we'll do what we got to do to try to manage, you know, that to older age class bulls. And it's hard sometimes trying to catch up with wild populations. Sometimes you end up with a surplus number of bulls, so it doesn't show up in your data until the decline's really kicked in a little more. But yeah, we're trying to make fairly aggressive cuts to get back to where we need to be. So.
And I saw some numbers in our Book Cliffs meeting. You know, there's still issues with the pregnancy rates, and there's some other factors coming into this. There's the drought and the pregnancy rates, and there's some caution moving forward because it doesn't look like there's a real boom of calves coming along.
Yeah, we've been pretty concerned about the Book Cliffs for a few years now. And we did a pretty intense study for the last 3 years looking at, collaring neonates, newborn elk calves, looking at pregnancy rates. And some of the data that we've got through that study is pretty concerning. We're seeing a lot of those elk are quite old. Pregnancy rates seem to oscillate quite a bit. A lot of those cows are not breeding back the following year. A lot of cows will be pregnant and then will not be pregnant the next year. A lot of our cow elk. We're seeing pregnancy rates jump from, in the 50% range to the mid 80% range, kind of bouncing back and forth every year. And a lot of that stuff is really unprecedented and hasn't been documented in elk before. So we're facing some interesting and hard challenges in the Book Cliffs. We've got a working group put together that, I know Dusty and Brett have been really involved in that, worked on that, and some of these other folks here as well. And, it's a challenge, and we're working on it. And it does feel like we're playing catch up a little bit, but we're trying to get there.
Any questions from the RAC? I want to bring up. Do you have a question? Go ahead, Daniel.
I do. What was the harvest success on the spike elk hunt for the rifle season when it went to the 5 day?
So I pulled the numbers up just today. The data is not all completely finalized yet. It will be, when it comes out in the annual report. So, but ballpark, it was right around 20-21% for the rifle spike hunt in the Book Cliffs, which is, it was a little bit higher for hunters that were in the roadless area. But a lot of those folks end up going guided, or a lot of folks are hunting with Flying J outfitters in there. Which is pretty close to what the statewide average was for success rate. So
there was a fewer hunters for some reason last year on the Book Cliffs, spike hunters. So the percentage of take was similar, but the harvest number was down, I believe, from the previous year.
So I went through that data again, Brett. So we had, and this is still in draft form. It might be, if you see a final report and it's plus or minus a few, but the latest version of the data I've got, we had 509 hunters hunted spikes in the Book Cliffs. They harvested 103 spikes for 20% overall success.
That's pretty consistent with what I was saying, because in the past we had around 1,000 the first year.
It's been 800, between 800, yeah, 900,
so
pretty
the
consistently.
Success
last
rate was similar, but the numbers were down. So the take was around 100. That 1 year we maxed out at about 200 spikes out there. So the actual number was down considerably on the number harvested. And it was just related to less hunters, I think.
Well, one of the things too is we're looking at those pregnancy rates, And in those years when you have 50% pregnancy, you know, that fall, you're hunting the year before's calves as yearling bulls. But, you know, if we had 50% pregnancy in, I was going to write it down somewhere, but we had, you know, if you have 50% pregnancy a year and a half from there when you hunt in the fall, you know, that whole age cohort, there's about half as many animals as there is when you have a year when you have 87% pregnancy. So if you want to time the years when you decide to hunt spikes in the book cliffs, you need to time it a year and a half from the spring when we only have, you know, 50% pregnancy. So, you know, this coming fall should be a pretty good one in the book cliffs because it'll coincide with one of those cohorts where we had 80-something percent pregnancy rates, whereas last fall, 2021, coincided with a cohort where we only had about 50% pregnancy in our cow elk. So that can be driving some of the success and just the abundance and what hunters are seeing with regard to that yearling age class when you have, you know, a 40% plus change in pregnancy rates from year to year. So you kind of almost want to hunt spikes in the book cliffs every other year and time it with those years when that cohort's going to be more abundant.
And we can have some more discussion about that when we talk about the antlerless tags because of the age class, which the division feels, and the BYU study is indicating that the age of the cows is a contributing factor there. I want to discuss one issue on the antro hams hunt. Back, if you remember how that happened, we'd had kind of a disagreement with the division and they'd recommended it went to a general season area. And this RAC had unanimously recommended that it stay limited entry. So we went to the wildlife board with, you know, the two extremes of opinion. And it was just a disagreement. That was fine. But the wildlife board chose to nobody had recommended a hams hunt on either side. And that was their attempt to come up with some middle ground. And I was there and the discussion went that this will give us an opportunity to maybe get some more bonus preference points gone by providing some opportunity. And we'll wait 2 years until the elk committee meets and let them make the decision. But in the meantime, we'll go with a hams hunt. And that will do two things. Their vision was it would do two things. It would provide more opportunity to help with some of the preference point issues, and it would harvest more bull elk to maybe take the top age class off that unit in case it goes general. So that limited entry preference points could be used to harvest some animals. So last year, this board approved, this RAC approved the 20 and 20. We ended up taking, Derek, almost exactly the same amount of elk as when it was limited entry. And it probably didn't achieve a whole lot more opportunity either. I don't know how many limited entry tags we had, but it went up maybe slightly.
Eight or nine.
Yeah, so a little bit. So the division is trying to be proactive, and they've recommended 30 and 30 this year. I would throw out that, and this is not biologically supported, this is the politics of if it's going to go general, we ought to provide some opportunity in the meantime. I would ask the RAC if there was interest in maybe recommending a few more tags. I spoke with Joe, and his opinion was, you know, he'd be very comfortable with 40 and 40. As a recommendation from the RAC.
And would they be hams? Just hams only?
Well, there's the 30-day bow season. When we say 30 and 30, there's 30 tags that are currently archery.
Okay.
And then there's 30 in the month of October that are hams. And so I'm asking the question of the RAC of whether we want to make a recommendation to maybe do a little more and achieve what the Wildlife Board was hoping for.
Does anybody know what the points are? How many points did it take to draw that unit last year with the bow? Any guess? You know, I like that idea.
The archery was fairly reasonable. It was six or seven, yeah. You know,
they're,
points.
They're talking about going to a general season. Boy, I like that recommendation. If it looks like it's going to go that way, I'd rather try to eliminate some of the points out there before it does. You know, I'm just making comments to.
That's going to be a decision of the Elk Committee that meets and starts meeting in a year from now. Is that correct, Dax?
The Elk Committee is underway. It started meeting, and Daniel's on the Elk Committee from our region.
And I know providing opportunity, I mean, I expect it to come around again because providing opportunity for more general season areas for elk is a big issue.
Yeah.
Because we know of the demand, and I'm not speaking for the division, but you know, I expect it to go that direction. I was at the Wildlife Board, and it was kind of a interim type motion. And so anyway, I'll just leave that. If somebody's interested in making that a part of the motion, that's fine. If not, that's fine also.
Daniel, what are you hearing on that, or
from the lowdown I've got from the people that have hunted it, there was some sentiment shared last week as well at the meeting, but it's been a well-received idea, and those that participated in the hunt really enjoyed it.
The hams?
Yep. And they really liked it. It actually ended up being a pretty quality experience in that manner. So I would be a little leery throwing basically doubling the amount of people out there from what it was, because that's what.
What are you hearing, Noah? What's your thoughts on it going to a general season?
No. So it's being brought up in committee, right? In the committee, it's going to be talked about, but we didn't go into any discussion on yet what everybody wants to do. We talked about goods, bads, and everything up to today, and then we're going to move forward with some data and go from there. But as far as doing away with that or going back to general season, I've never heard any discussion on that. So,
you know, that was that. So could you repeat what you said about increasing the opportunity for hams? You think that's
it's been well received by the sportsmen, and a lot of people actually enjoy it and want to see more opportunity. So now it's a balance of, okay, if it goes that route, when, where, and how, but meet the demand of the general public on general season units. So that's part of what the committee is going to have to dance with. But there's no talk about, I've not heard any rumblings about these hams units this year going back to general season.
Just the anthro, and that's one we're talking about, correct? Because the anthro, yes. You know, if it was, there's a chance that it's going to go back to a general season hunt, I would like to see us increase the tags. But I guess we really don't know that. You know,
We don't.
We don't, but your feeling was, Bryce, that there's a little rumbling that it might.
I don't want to speculate what the Elk Committee is going to do, but that was the position of the division going into this, that that's a prime candidate for more opportunity. And same with the West Desert. There was a group of them. There was a cache unit and the West Desert and anthro. And if they're going to provide more general season opportunity, that's the likely candidates.
Well, one of the big directions to that statewide Elk Committee is to try to find places where we can get more opportunity for general season elk hunting. You know, the any bull permits, just the demand for those has been so strong. They've been selling out super quick. So that is, we're definitely getting way ahead of where the committee is at with this at this point. But I do think, you know, those are things that are on the table that committee is going to be looking at. Are there units out there where there's potential to change the management strategy on those units to provide more general season hunting opportunity? And the anthro checks a lot of the boxes as far as the criteria that's why the division recommended it being in any bull unit a couple of years ago. It checks a lot of those boxes on criteria.
Your thoughts was to go to 10 more tags than what the division has offered on both the units. Is that what?
They've recommended an increase from 20 and 20 to 30 and 30.
30. Mm-hmm.
And I'm throwing out the option that there's probably opportunity, not biologically, but just with all the things that are going on out there, to provide a little more opportunity or make a recommendation to the Wildlife Board that, and Joe, I discussed it with him. He's sick and he couldn't make it tonight. He was going to come, but he's sick. And he said he would be comfortable with a little more increase to 40 and 40 if the RAC wanted to do that.
Yeah. And I think the division would be, you know, fine with that as well. On these hams hunts, it's still kind of a new thing. We're still kind of feeling it out to see where we go. But the direction from the board and the intent of these hunts is to give more opportunity. I don't think the division would object if the rec decided to go more. I think that's fine.
So what was the success they had last year? Do you have that offhand?
I know.
65 for the hams, and then the archery was like 25.
25%-ish archery, 65% on the hams. So it's actually fairly decent. That's in the normal range for our limited entry archery elk hunts.
And it was a tough year.
And for the hams
with the water situation out there last year on anthro. So that's pretty good success.
What's your feelings, Dax, as it due to that, if we give another 10 tags on top of what the division has been offering, would it devastate that unit bad enough when we, if we went back and made it a general season or went back to, we kept it a limited entry unit, would it take 2 or 3 years to recover by adding that many more tags, or what's kind of hard to guess, I guess, a little bit, you know.
Do you have a feel for that, Derek?
You're only getting set to the mic. Sorry.
Is this on? Okay. I don't think you would make, in a year or two, you could make cuts if you needed to and be right back where you wanted to be. I mean, you're talking if 25% success and you put 10 more out there, you're only going to be killing 2, maybe 3 more elk on the archery. It's not going to make significant impacts to that population.
Does the public have any comments on this?
I want to speak to that a little bit, Brett, if you don't mind.
Oh, you bet. How about it?
So my concerns with that is the more tags we give, then why didn't it just go general, right? So to provide that limited entry opportunity, right, they're increasing 10. We're, the thought being discussed now is doubling that. So you're basically doubling the amount of tags that are out there. That elk herd is not very big. You're talking 1,100 head, I believe, is the total population. And so now when you take the amount of hunters that were there last year and recommend doubling that, now the competition, the quality, the opportunity with a primitive weapon, you start to defeat that objective. 10, I think, is a great step. And taking a couple more bulls is okay. But then you double the amount of people that was there last year, you're going to start diminishing that limited entry opportunity. I mean, if we're trying to develop opportunity, then it should have just stayed general in that case. But that's not what we had a consensus on, was to keep it somewhat of a higher quality hunt.
I understand that. It is, they have compensated by making the long seasons the whole month for the bow hunt, including the rut in the hams structure. And then pretty much the whole month of October, isn't it, Derek?
It's all of October and half of November.
Oh, so it's a 6-week hams portion and a 4-week. So they have, there's a lot of, specifically to that unit, there's a long time and a lot of space. I know water availability changes that, because if it's a poor water year, a lot of the elk leave, and also it concentrates the hunters on the few sources that are left. So depending on the year, on a drought year, what you're describing, I think would be very accurate. And on a really good year, it's a big area. I don't know.
So when you get into September in the archery hunt, everybody's going to hunt the rut, right?
Right.
You're going to use the rut as your advantage. So typically a lot of people don't hunt that early. They're going to wait and hunt that prime time, right?
True.
In retrospect, as an archer, that's what I prefer to hunt, and that's the big sentiment. Now, with the ham side of that hunt, getting that later season when them elk start migrating in there and then bulls start coming off the Wasatch and different places like that, then people find those times where they want to go out and hunt in a higher demand. Now, they get long times to do it, but they all seem to be there at the same time. Whether it's 45 days or 9 days, it just seems to be Saturday and Sunday seem to be the hot ticket on a 5-day hunt. Later on in the season, it dwindles off, and then weather comes and they all run out there again. So I just have concerns about that myself.
But. Okay. And nothing said it has to stay even either, and if everything's on the table as far as that goes. Tim?
I'd like to add to that, too. I'd take an increase of 5 because you guys are forgetting on this side of the fence, you guys got us hunting. So, you know, and a lot of our tribal members are starting to hunt that more. You guys ain't even counting the ones that are being killed on our side. So the herd might even be smaller than you think. And the quality ain't there no more. So why would you even call it a limited entry hunt and take somebody's points when he's not even got a chance of killing a 350 bull? You know, that's my opinion.
Dax, I've got a quick question. Is that herd, is it under objective, over objective? Where are we at on numbers on that one?
It's over objective, but it's a tricky one where we have a winter objective and it a little bit depends on the time of year. We definitely have documented a lot of movement of elk that come across from the Wasatch, so that Aveniquin subunit of the Wasatch. And some winters, if we have a good enough amount of snow that we should go and fly, you know, a lot of those years we'll have more elk on anthro because a lot of more have moved over in the winter. During the summer, it's probably a lot closer to actually just being at the objective. So it a little bit depends on the time of year. That's why most of our cow hunts are quite late in the year. And some of our cow hunts even straddle both the Aveniquin and anthro unit, even though they're two separate units, just because we know those are the same elk. Is that fair, Derek? Is that accurate?
Okay. Okay. And your age objective on your bulls is about where you want it?
So that's one of the reasons we recommended moving the anthro unit to a general season unit, because the age objective was just kind of bouncing all over the place. You know, one year it'd be 8, the next year it'd be 5. And so, and we'd have pretty small sample sizes. Success rate was varying a ton year to year on the archery hunt. In the hams hunt designation that it's in now, there isn't necessarily an age objective associated with the unit.
Okay.
And I believe the hams hunt is not really intended to be a trophy hunt. Is that correct? It's kind of a opportunity hunt.
So, you know, within our current, you know, the way we hunt elk in Utah, we've kind of got everything running the spectrum from, you know, spike hunts to, you know, a limited entry tag on the Boulder or the San Juan, or, you know, one of those units that's seen as kind of a premier trophy elk unit. And we've got a little bit of everything in between. You know, we've got an any bull hunt. Then the hams hunts would probably be, you know, the beginning of what you'd call like a limited entry type hunt. It's got the lowest criteria with regard to, you know, age or a trophy potential. So, you know, there's a diversity. Not every unit can or should be managed the same as the San Juan, and we probably shouldn't manage every single unit in the state the same way we manage, you know, the any bull hunt units as well. So there's diversity. It's on the lower end of the trophy, you know, kind of that limited entry part of the scale. It's on the lower end of that, the lowest end of that.
JC, did you have a comment? Thank you.
I'm a little guy. I got to bring this down a ways. On the spike hunt, it's been kind of mixed in with the bull hunt here. You give some numbers on the Buckcliff's kill ratio last fall. It's easy to understand. You reduced the length of the hunt from 13 days to 5 days. You reduced the number of hunters that went out there and hunt that 5 days better than half. And so that means you killed less than half of the spikes that you normally would. So that's just, I think, easy to understand the numbers that he just gave us about 20% and only taking about half the spikes has been taken. The question I have is, because you reduced the number of days that we was allowed to hunt in the Buckcliffs last year down to 5, you did reduce the number of hunters. Is that going to continue this year? I'm hearing all kinds of ugly rumors about that hunt being hammered some more, and that disturbs me a little, because we're already about as hard as we can get without starting to get a lot of public protest. And one of those publics that's going to protest is going to be me. We need to have some kind of an opportunity somewhere for us folks that just want to buy a tag and take a grandkid out and introduce them to hunting. That's about the last place that you can buy an over-the-counter tag is the spike hunt. And we're getting beat down and beat down and beat down on our on the Buckland spike hunt, which is where I grew up. That's my hunt. In that area, we're getting beat down pretty hard. And I think it's probably, I'm feeling that it's a little bit unfair. Thank you.
So the seasons are set in our November meeting. And the hunt that was approved on the Book Cliffs for spikes was at the full length season this year. Yeah, whatever the regular hunt is, that is what the season is this year. And it was not shortened by motion like the previous year. I didn't want to drag this on forever, but I just threw that. I still don't really have a feel on the rack of how we want to go on this one. So if there's any more questions or any more discussion, let's have it now. And
Mr.
then
Chair,
we'll open it up.
I'll talk about the public online comments here for just a minute. There's only six people responded on the bull and buck pronghorn. Zero strongly agreed. Two of them somewhat agreed. Zero neither agreed nor disagreed. Two somewhat disagreed and two strongly disagreed. So, people were kind of across the board on this, but a pretty small number of people actually commented.
Thank you. And that's on the whole bull elk.
Yeah. Bull and pronghorn. Mm-hmm.
And pronghorn, excuse me. Any more discussion? Anybody want to have any? Okay, now that I've muddied up the whole proposal, I'm opening it up to motion.
You know, Mr. Chair, with your feelings on that anthro unit, I think I'm gonna throw it out there just for grins for the motion to let's go ahead and I'd like to make the motion on that anthro unit that we do raise those up to 40, another 10 on each on the archery and the hams, both as we discussed. I feel like it's kind of worth the chance. If it is a chance to go to an open season unit, general season, you know, if we could eliminate some points out there, I like that thought. But I'd like to make that as a motion, if that makes
sense.
Can
you make a motion? Is he recused or can he make a motion?
This isn't anything voting on diamonds, so.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So this is a side motion, aside from the packet.
Yeah.
We have a motion to increase the hams permit numbers on the anthro unit from 30 and 30 as recommended to 40 and 40. Do we have a second? Okay. For lack of a second, that motion will not proceed. And I will open it up to a motion, an alternate motion.
I'd like to make a motion to pass the elk portion of the packet as recommended by the Division of Wildlife.
Do you want to include the antelope?
Oh, yeah.
The pronghorn?
Yeah, and the pronghorn. Sorry.
Presented?
As presented.
By the division. Okay, we have a motion. Do we have a second?
I'll second it.
Is that Richie?
Yeah.
Richie, second that. All in favor? Were you a yes? Okay. I have 3, 4, 5, 6. All opposed? Okay. The motion passes 6-0. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, if I'd like to make comments on the, if I could, while we're on the elk units, Dax, I'd sure like to see a map of the Book Cliffs and with an overlaying bear season's on, cougar season's on, deer season's on, elk season's on, spike units on. I still, and I've made this comments before, I feel like that Book Cliffs, elk and deer numbers, we have got to give those animals a break somewhere along the line. I'd like to see a study, or maybe there has been, but I'd like to see something. You know, you stick 1,100 spike elk hunters out there. Last year was the least amount of complaints that I've had on the Book Cliffs. since I've been a commissioner. Whether it was a spike hunt, I can't tell you. It was, I wasn't being, I mean, called and called and called. But, you know, I'd like to, I still think that to help I feel like we've got to give them a break to help the elk have a chance to get bred, to carry their calves, and same with the deer. But, you know, I'd like to see something on that. It's a lot smarter of me to say if that's, I'm up in the air about what I'm saying or talking about. But anyway, that's my just comments.
I think that's a good comment. And then, you know, we all know anthro and the book cliffs, the oil activity has a significant impact on the disturbance. And so it's not only hunters, it's all the changes that are occurring. I mean, that's us that know anthro, that's been the big issue. There's roads everywhere now in anthro, and that used to be pretty remote. And that's why that unit has changed from a premier unit in the state to all this debate we're having of what to do with it. You know, that's a big factor. That's not the whole reason, but that's a big factor. Thank you, Dax.
Yeah, Commissioner, we can get you dates if you need. You know, I appreciate the concern for the book because there's a lot of folks really concerned. I'm happy to hear you had less complaints this year. We got a lot of folks that are working really hard from, you know, a lot of different partners, not just the division, to try to do things to address issues down there. And we have cut a lot of permits on the limited entry hunts as well for bucks and bulls. You know, we're seeing some real progress on some things that I think will pay off. And we have a ton of study data, you know, GPS collar location data. And, you know, we can look at some of those things, and we've looked at some of those things on some other units in the state as far as, you know, if hunting pressure and disturbance is pushing animals around and moving them, you know, we have the information to look and answer some of those questions.
Thank you. We'll now move on to the number item 7, once in a lifetime permit recommendations. Riley Peck is here to give us a brief overview, and then we'll ask questions.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair.
Can I ask one thing? Can you turn on the mic or mute the mic if you're not talking?
Yeah, thank you. And Dax did a fantastic job at kind of giving an overview of how we make recommendations and manage for elk and deer and pronghorn. And once-in-a-lifetime species are kind of all across the board. We manage everything from the number of older age rams for bighorn sheep to total population objective on bison to number of adults for mountain goats and an overall population objective for bison. So we kind of hit the entire gamut for once-in-a-lifetime species. Our populations are much smaller. They're much less abundant across the state. And so instead of seeing sometimes hundreds, if not thousands of permit fluctuations, we are down to single digits, you know, 5-6 at times. And so our recommendations reflect that today with only one very small exception. All of the permits that were recommended follow within that plan for their specific species. So it's kind of the update, and be happy to take any questions or hear any comments or anything you'd like on the once in a lifetime species.
Your recommendations are pretty much stable, aren't they? With the exception of a few units?
With the exception of a few units, we have altered very little from years past. And that's what I say. Sometimes, even when we make changes with once in a lifetime species, they can be as few as one or two permits as compared to the past. Yeah.
Except for Chalk Creek goats.
Goats are one of those that, you know, I think that we've talked about the drought. And even though they're a high elevation animal, we are seeing some issues with goats. And to our best guess, drought is the driving factor in those. In a high elevation alpine habitat, we're seeing that they can be impacted. And so our recommendations are reflective of that. So, yes.
Would you or Randall, would you like to just discuss the work you're doing on the goats for the rack, just so they know what you're doing with the collars and the trying to figure out what's happening on the UNS?
Sure. Randall Thacker, biologist for the, is this on? for the on the south slope of the Uintas. Our goats here had been doing quite well historically. They'd really been doing well, but the last 4 or 5 years, we've seen them take a turn and not do quite as well. And actually about 10 years now total, if we go back to when they from when they kind of peaked out on us. And so we were able to go out this fall and catch and radio collar 30 goats across the Uintas, the south slope. We're really excited to get that information on that. We don't have any great survival data for goats across the Uintas or anywhere else in the state. You know, if we don't have collars on, we haven't had the data. So the survival data gives us an indication of what these GPS collars that we have. They're just like the deer. Gives us the opportunity to find out what's killing the individual animals. So we can gather some of that information, as well as a survival rate throughout the year. Both Billy's and Annie's were collared across. And so we did have a few of those collars that failed on us. And so we went back out and put a couple more collars back on in just about a month and a half ago to try to fill some of those gaps back in. A couple of collars were, I guess, they had bad batteries. I don't know. We can't figure out for sure what it is, but a couple of them did kind of fail on us. But we do have our first collars on the Uintas that we've had on, first GPS collars we've ever had on the Uintas. And then but even the radio collars that we had on the Uintas were very, the data was quite old. It was back from the original releases back in 80 or 97 and 98 and 2000 were the last ones that would have collar. They only last a few years. And so we hadn't had information on what the survival rates really were doing out there on our goats. And we also have some questions. We count these goats on the Uintas with the helicopter, of course, is how we get our trend counts. And then we fly these usually in August and or even early September, depending on the year, depending on the weather and helicopter availability stuff. But so we do those flights, and we've noticed the last few flights that the goats have seen, some of the goats at least, are starting to utilize the trees a lot more than we saw when they were first turned loose on the Uintas. They used to stay up on top of the ballies a lot more and be more available and easier to see. So our sightability, we believe, was higher, in past as these goats. And I think particularly on drier years like this last year when we flew, on drought years, when it gets so hot and dry, we think that some of them are dropping, a higher percentage of them are dropping down into the trees to find areas that are probably got a little more vegetation left, a little more shade, a little cooler areas and that kind of stuff where they're going to find more feed. And so that may be contributing to our counts. And so we want to get the collars on. That'll facilitate us the next time. Then we do, we'll be putting a few more on again next year is our plan. We just met with Riley today to discuss that. We'll try to keep some enough collars on there too, that when we do fly again in a couple of years here into our next count, we'll have some collars. We'll be able to check and see what our sightability is. But because these collars are GPS collars, we can tell whether those trees, the accuracy on these collars is amazing. It's within 15, 20 feet usually, and especially if it's in the open. And we'll be able to tell how much they're utilizing down in the trees. And when we fly, we'll be able to go back and look at it the next day and say, okay, we missed two collared goats in that area because they were in the trees or not, So we'll be able to see some of that. That'll really help. I'm really excited to get the collars on and get the information we can get from these. We've also had kind of an interesting thing. We've had two of our goats in the mouth of White Rocks Canyon. We had six goats that we had collared that had moved down in there for the winter. We've had two of them killed by lions in the last month and a half down there. And that's, kind of interesting to know. Goats usually hang out in pretty remote, rugged country, of course, but they usually stay out of the trees a lot. But that group of goats moves down into the trees a fair amount right there. And we're seeing that maybe predation is, if we've got that, so two of the six collars in that area have been taken out by lions. I think we've got a lion that's learned how to hunt goats when they drop down in the trees there. So that's something we'll be kind of keeping an eye on, and maybe, there's maybe some management changes we can do there or something to address some of these things. So it'll give us a lot of good information. We're excited to have the radio collars on. I think it's going to be a really good project. Yeah. Probably was that one from White Rocks. Tim's got to get that one. They drop down those trees quite a bit, more than a lot of the other goats do, and I think that makes them vulnerable. Yeah, there's some that just stay there year-round down low. They aren't all coming down from up above, are they? Yeah, there are some that just stay there. A number of years ago, I know Brett had mentioned that he'd seen in that area had been up to 30 goats for a couple of years there that we had hanging in that area. And now there's 8 or 10, so.
I counted probably 20 that was hanging out right there.
There's people online can't hear you. If you can talk into a mic.
Thank you. But not recently, right?
I haven't been up there recently. That was back during the hunting. Yeah. No, that was
this year.
Last year.
Last year.
Oh, last year.
Yeah.
Good. Good. Good to hear it. So.
Sorry to interrupt your presentation. I thought that would be interesting for the
that was fantastic. That. Wasn't interrupting so, at all. I appreciate that.
Any questions for Riley from the RAC? And just you have one? Thank you.
This is from the SFW again. 9 Mile Jack Creek Rocky Mountain Bighorn Sheep Unit. Division recommended 3 permits. SFW recommends 2 permits. Reason being, generally, the sportsman tag and the statewide tag hunt this unit, and we feel like this is too much pressure for the number of sheep on this unit. Thank you.
That was it? You support the rest of the recommendation?
Okay. Online comments. Well, there were only 4 people commented on this. 3 of them somewhat agreed. 1 of them strongly disagreed. So that's it.
Any more discussion from the RAC? Okay. I would entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion to accept the once-in-a-lifetime proposal as presented from the Division of Wildlife.
I'll second it.
We have a motion and we have a second. All in favor? Unanimous. Thank you. Thank you, Riley. We will do the antlerless permit recommendations now. This will be all species antlerless permits.
I'm going to grab my laptop here really quick just because I have some numbers on there that I want to be able to look at. But again, our antlerless recommendations are really focused on managing populations. Managing populations and... Does Riley have mine right there? Let me grab that one. Karen. Thanks, Riley. It's focused on managing populations and in some instances dealing with depredation situations or disease situations. So that's what the bulk of our antlerless recommendations are in the region. We do most of what we're recommending is really similar to what we've done in past years. We do have 2 new antlerless hunts, one for doe deer in the Ouray Valley area and one for doe pronghorn in the Ouray Valley area, just because we have a lot of animals, a lot of conflict, a lot of depredation on private lands down there. Other than that, most of the rest of the antlerless hunts in our region are really similar to last year.
I believe there's antlerless moose on the north slope still, right?
There's some antlerless moose permits recommended on the Wasatch and a couple other units. We don't have any antlerless moose permits recommended in our region.
Okay, thank you. If you have any specific questions, there was the book cliffs cow elk hunt, which was still recommended at equal to what the tags were last year, right? Dax, where we ended up on that?
If you look in the tables for the antlerless permits in the book cliffs, it shows like there's an increase, but actually that is the same number that were issued last year after we made adjustments for drought in the August board meeting. So if you'll remember through the process, if we are experiencing severe drought, there's an opportunity to increase antlerless permits just directly through the Wildlife Board in August. And we did that last year. Just June and July were brutally hot and dry. We'd had a dry spring. And so we recommended emergency increases to antlerless elk permits on some units in the state. And so our recommendations for cow permits in the Book Cliffs for this coming year are the same number that we had last year after that number had been adjusted for drought.
Correct.
And because of prolonged, ongoing cumulative drought impacts in the Book Cliffs, we want to continue to try to harvest some elk. We've got some issues with low pregnancy rates, like I mentioned, really a very old elk population compared to other elk populations in the state. And having some additional harvest can help alleviate some of the pressure on limited forage on the summer range, potentially help lower that age class and make that population more productive so that when some of all these habitat and water projects start to kick in, we can have an elk population that's poised to grow and do well.
There is quite a bit of concern that the calving rates, the pregnancy rates being so low. When we looked at that the other day, the age class of the elk, it was nearly half of the cows out there were 10 years old. And it's not exactly known, but 12 years old is probably about at the end of the most elk's productive age. And so it's kind of an odd thing that you need to hunt more elk to get more production, but that's really what's going on out there.
We've documented cow elk as old as 27 years old, but and we actually document a lot of old elk in the Book Cliffs based on captured elk and aging those. Average age in the Book Cliffs is 12. Average age on the other units in the state where we've captured elk was 9. So, through the harvest data, we're seeing the same thing on, we've been starting to send out tooth packets to some of our antlerless elk hunters. And then we are starting to document and tease some of this out of the data that these older cows are much less likely to be pregnant and very unlikely that they're going to breed back and be pregnant 2 years in a row. So once you get to that point where we have an elk population that if the average age is 12, you know, that means probably half of them are older than that. And it's a lot of those cows are not having a calf, and they're still there. They're still living. Once they survive to adulthood, their survival is pretty high. It's pretty good, but they're not producing anything. They're just consuming feed and not producing calves. So that's part of why, even though we are under the overall population objective for the Book Cliffs, we want to continue to try to harvest some animals and lower that age class. And also our population objective is probably not a reasonable or responsible one at this point in time, just because of the condition out there and the prolonged drought effects.
Thank you. Any other discussion? Okay. I would open it up for motion.
Just a second.
Oh, wait, I'm sorry, Miles.
I've got to summarize the public comments again. 6 respondents on this. 1 strongly agreed, 1 somewhat disagreed, 3 somewhat disagreed, and 1 strongly disagreed. The bulk of the discussion was surrounded the Book Cliff cow hunts.
On the strongly disagreed, it was
just specific comments. They were talking about increasing the Book Cliff cow hunts and permits, and were asking, the comments were concerned about increasing those on the Book Cliffs. Yeah.
Yes.
This is SFW again. The SFW does it for the Pine Valley unit. SFW does not support harvesting any doe deer on the Pine Valley. So,
thank you.
Thank you. What is the recommendation there, Dax?
Maybe someone could help me out and look it up. 40, and it's pretty specific hunt boundary around some ag areas where we have some conflict. In nowhere in the state of Utah are we harvesting does at like a unit-wide level to try to reduce deer populations. We do have several doe hunts across the state. We have several in this region, but they're pretty strategic, pretty surgical to try to target animals, you know, resident animals that spend a disproportionate amount of time on private lands or that are causing damage to crops or that may be animals that have a high rate of disease. You know, those those are the instances and the cases where we're harvesting doe deer. A lot of places in the state, we harvest cow elk to manage populations. Almost nowhere in the state are we harvesting doe deer to reduce populations. It's very strategic, very surgical to try to address specific issues.
Thank you.
Brett, I've got a question for Dax, and it's probably what the public have a question on. How are you going to monitor the age of cows that are killed out there in the book cliffs? Where you would like to target the older cows, which I understand. How are you going to monitor that to see if the hunt has the desired effect?
So we've been sending tooth packets, tooth envelopes to all of our hunters, and asking them to send in teeth that we get aged at the lab. I wish there was a really specific way that we could age cows and have hunters specifically target, you know, we want to target the old ones that have the yellowish gray hair instead of the, you know, blondes only, no brunettes or redheads. That's just not possible. I could see the law enforcement guys getting nervous when I even mentioned something like that, only harvesting a certain age class of cows. But it's a good question, and it's a tricky one. We're trying to figure out what's the best way to do this. We do know if we have a population that is skewed towards an older age class, generally the harvest is going to take older age class animals, just because that's what's available and that's what's there. I wish we had a better, more precise way to target older cows, but right now we don't. We'll just have to continue to monitor ages on harvested cows, and then we're going to be monitoring ages on multiple units around the state, and then we can compare that and see if we're making progress in the meantime while we all kind of keep our fingers crossed and hope for some rain and for some conditions that allow all this other work that's taking place in the book cliffs to kick in and start helping out.
All right, any other discussion from the RAC?
I got a question, Mr. Chair. So was this year a flight year for the deer counts on Pine Valley and trying to remember the other one that had a substantial population decrease?
So we don't count deer. We don't do aerial counts for deer.
Pine Valley, Zion were the two.
Yeah, so we don't do aerial counts for deer, but we have really intensive monitoring. We have better data on deer now than we've ever had. We have, you know, a lot of these units, we have really significant sample sizes of collars on adult does and on fawns. So we can get really good survival data and plug that into our models. And I know some people are uncomfortable with models as a way to you know, figure out your deer populations, but a model is a function of the inputs. It's a function of the data that you put in. And we have really good data that we're able to use and put in those models. And then when our biologists go out and do their postseason classification and collect on the ground data from deer, you know, we can compare and reconcile those numbers and see if they're tracking with what the models predict we should see. And they're getting tighter and tighter. They're getting better and better. Our biologists classify a pretty substantial sample of deer on those units. I know on the Pine Valley unit, the biologist down there classified over 2,000 deer and his postseason classifications in November. So it's definitely the sample size combined with the collar data. You know, we're feeling really good about the way our deer populations are modeling these days. And we had seen on those units, specifically the Pine Valley and Zion units, that we had no fawn recruitment. You know, we just weren't growing new fawns and our does were getting older and older. And we finally just hit that tipping point where the does all started dying and there was no up and coming age class to replace them. And so that we've seen, you know, pretty precipitous declines on those units. Again, those are a couple of units in the, you know, southernmost, the driest, hottest part of the state. And the drought seems to be hitting there exceptionally hard.
Thank you. Any other discussion? Okay, I would open up for a motion.
I'll make a motion to accept the antlerless permit recommendations as presented by the Division of Wildlife.
We have a motion to accept the antlerless permit recommendations as presented by the division. Do we have a second?
Yeah, I'll second it.
It's Daniel. Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor? We're good on the end. All opposed? Motion passes 6-1. With that, we'll move into our last item. Chad made it all the way to Vernal. Had to wait to the very last minute. Chad Wilson is Private Lands Public Wildlife Coordinator, and he'll give us a brief overview of the 2022 CWMU antlerless permit recommendations.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. So really on this, there's 21 either renewal applications or change applications or new applications that are being voted on, which would be a total of 47 total private permits and 216 public permits.
And there was, the division didn't have any, the applications were all approved?
Yeah. And those applications, the renewals and the new applications were approved in the fall.
Okay. So this is just the numbers?
Yep.
Okay. Questions from the RAC?
I don't really have a question, but I do have a comment. I've been involved in some discussion with folks on the landowner voucher program and how they look and how the CWMUs look. Chad, I don't think we need to do it tonight, but maybe in one of your next presentations or something you do online, I don't think the public really understands to a large degree the CWMU program and how those tags are distributed and how they get those numbers. Maybe just in a future time, if you could maybe take a few minutes in one of your presentations and better explain that, because I don't think I fully understand it a lot of the time. And just talking to folks, they don't understand how those numbers are derived. And like I say, I don't know that we need to do it tonight, but maybe in one of your presentations, if you could educate again.
Yeah, that's a fair comment, and it is a challenge even for us at times. And just to disclose, we will be opening the CWMU rule up and maybe tightening some of that up. So probably next year at this time, or when the CWMU rule comes through, that I hope that's a lot clearer on that process.
Chad, we do kind of briefly over on the antlerless permits talk about the public versus private portion of the typical?
Yeah, so you see a majority of them come to the public. I'm just going to pull up my presentation so I can work off of that. So there's different splits. A lot of times they'll choose a 90-10 split, and we don't have a ton of pronghorn or deer tags, so this is mostly out, but they'll choose a 90-10 split the majority of the time. Sometimes we see the 80-20, but if they choose that 90-10 split, 100% of those tags will go to the public, the antlerless tags. If they choose like an 80-20, then it's a 40-60 with the 60% going to the public. So it's I guess the benefit for the public there is, you know, they don't get as many antlered tags, but when it comes to antlerless, they get the bulk of them.
If they want more bull tags to sell, then they give more public antlerless tags. They get a better, the public gets a better, a higher number of them, nearly 100%. You call it a 90-10, but it's...
Well, it's 90-10 on the bulls.
On the bulls.
But on the antlerless, it's 100%.
It's 100% for the antlerless goes to the public. So in general, the CWMU program, though it's always taken tweaks by Chad for various situations, is very popular, right?
Yeah, it's a good program that's pretty well received.
Thank you. I don't want to have any discussion on it tonight, but Chad's also he's the private lands coordinator, so next month you'll see him again, because we'll be dealing with the landowner association rule. and he's really looking forward to coming to Vernal.
I can't wait to be back.
And so we'll see quite a bit of Chad next month. Miles, what do you have for comments on this one?
Only three people commented. One strongly agreed, one somewhat agreed, and one strongly disagreed. So.
Okay. Is there any other questions? All right. I would entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion to accept the CWMU numbers as presented.
I'll second it.
We have a motion and a second to accept 2022 CWMU antlerless permit recommendations as presented by the division. All in favor? All opposed? Motion passes 6-1. And is there any other business, Miles? Oh, we do update them on the officers.
That's right. So Dan Beta had been our vice chair until he's left. So that leaves that vice chair position vacant. So I wanted to give everybody a heads up tonight. We need to have somebody else take that role. So I would ask anybody to send me nominations for somebody that could be the vice chair who you'd like to have that be, and then we can take a vote and take action on that at our next meeting. So anyhow, so just email me, shoot me a text, give me a call who you'd like to nominate to be vice chair, and we'll take care of that business next meeting.
What are their duties?
Duties essentially, if Brett's not able to make the wildlife board meeting or this meeting, they would fill in his behalf.
You have to cover the wildlife board on all hunting seasons when I'm not available to go, and all holidays when I'm on vacation.
Have you ever missed one?
Yes, Dan actually would cover for me probably two or three times a year. So it is a significant commitment, and that. So they need to be aware of that. I'm kind of flaky. So with that, is there anything else? All right, I would look for a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Anybody disagree with that?
I second.
Okay, we're out of here. Thank you. Thank you to the division and the public that attended.